Let's have just a word of prayer. Lord, we thank thee for this opportunity. Open our hearts and minds and help us to see you, follow you, love you, and Lord, lead us straight into your kingdom. We pray for Jesus' sake. Amen. Amen. Now, the theme is the three angels' message and evangelism. Now, let me just read you something here that I discovered. Now, for 50 years, I've preached evangelism, taught Word of God everywhere around. And it says here in volume 7 of the testimonies, the medical work is the right hand of the gospel. Now, the medical work is the right hand of the gospel. Now, to me, the right hand has been cut off. It is necessary to the advancement of the cause. Amen. Now, the reason why I'm stopping there is because, you know, every time I preach these days, I'm preaching a sermon to myself. I went through the academy, went through the college, went to Andrews University, went to all these places. And to me, if this is the right hand, they didn't tell me anything about it. So the right hand's been cut off. No, but look. As though men and women are led to see the importance of the right habits of living, the saving power of the truth will be made known. As the right hand of the three angels' message, God's methods of training, treating disease will be open doors for the entrance of the present truth. So the right hand has been cut off, and the door has been shut. Now, all the days of my ministry, this was never taught me to teach the people. Now, that's something, isn't it? Now, except from us here around here, have you ever thought anybody taught you about medical ministry work? Amen. You very seldom hear it. It's never told. Now, God, in his love and his mercy, I talked to you, tell you last night, has given us a clear path, a guarantee of salvation. And the guarantee is, if the Holy Spirit, we are invited into your life and into your heart, into your actions, and become a part of you, he will lead you straight into his kingdom. Now, in his mercy, he asks us as Seventh-day Adventists to proclaim the three angels. Now, the gentleman this morning read the three angels, but let's go to it one more time. Revelation 14. Revelation 14, and I'm only going to read verse 6. Now, he read verse 7. I'm going to read 6 and 7. And I saw an angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach. Everlasting means it doesn't ever end. It is the good news about Jesus Christ coming to the earth and saving us from our sins and then helping us perpetuate this gospel by living in us. Amen. The angel flew all over the world. Listen, Christ has come. Christ has come. Christ has come. He died for your sins. He left here in place the Holy Spirit. Tell it. Preach unto them that dwell on the earth and to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, what? Fear God. Fear God. Give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. And worship him that made heaven and earth and sea and the fountains of waters. He implies that there's somebody else around who wants to be worshipped beside God. There's Allah, and there's Buddha, and there's the Hindu. All these other gods want to be worshipped. He said, now, the God that you want to make sure you worship is the one that made heaven, the earth, and the sea, and the fountains of waters. Amen. That's clear. So he is the only one to be worshipped and respected. And he tells you, now look, the judgment or the decision for who I'm going to take back to my kingdom is here. The time is present. Listen. Obey me. You're supposed to be in, I want to be in you. My son is gone back to heaven, and here we are. Now, go to the first slide. What? What? Slide my finger. There you go. That it? All right. Now, let me ask you a question. How many of us have seen that illustration? Come on now. Now, just put your hand up. Now, some of you in here have seen that because I didn't show it to you. Yeah. No, wait, no, I ain't talking about you all that been following me around. But now, how many have seen that? Now, see, that's amazing. Now, the Lord in his mercy has showed us this and have illustrated this. Now can you see pretty much what it's talking about here? The Jewish feast and type and antitype. Can you read that? Okay, the next one, slide it to the left. Okay. Okay, can you see it better?
Yes.
All right, good. Now, what the Lord was so merciful to us in, he asked the people in the early 1840s to tell the world the gospel is here. Now, Jesus gave us this illustration in the Old Testament with these feasts and festivals. See? And he told the people of God, now everything you need is in the law. Now, the law you think in your head is the Ten Commandments, but he's thinking about law being the first five books of the Bible. This is in the first five books of the Bible. And they're illustrating everything that Jesus would do to help you be saved in his kingdom. Everything. And so all this has been forgotten because the devil just took it away and blinded everybody's eyes about it, and you can't see it. But thank God, the early founders named William Miller dug this out after careful, prayerful Bible study to make sure that the people in this time, in this date, in this age, would understand what Jesus is finally doing. Now, he put the Holy Spirit in you, showed you to walk with him, and now he says, I'm gone back. And he went back to sit beside the Father. Now, 2,300 years after the decree that Daniel prophesied, they found out that 1843 was a date that something on this earth was going to happen. They thought, William Miller thought, that the earth was going to be cleansed and Jesus was going to come. He added up wrong. He took 457 from 2300, and he ended up with 1843. He missed it by a year. But during that year, many of the people who were led to see this, they dropped out. Only a handful said, listen, something happened in heaven. We can't let this go. We can't forget about it. God is trying to show us something. We got to study and pray and read and find it out for that whole year, from 1843 to 1844. And this is what they found. A man by the name of S.S. Snow, O.R.L. Corozier, F.E.B. Hahn. They studied that Bible down to a T and found out that God was trying to show his people something through these feasts and festivals. The first thing they found out, that the real Lamb of God whose blood was shed on the cross, died on the very self same day that the children of Israel left Egypt and went into freedom. Very self same day. Passover. Where you get Passover from? The Lord told him, now look now, if you're going to get out of here, the only way you're going to get out of here is by taking the blood of that lamb. See, he don't want you to forget that blood. He don't want you to forget that lamb. You take the blood of that lamb and you dip it in some hyssop and you sprinkle it above that doorpost. And when the death angel passes by, he'll miss you and you can get out. So only saving grace that they had was the blood of that lamb over the doorpost on the very day was the Passover. Now the real Passover lamb that died was Jesus. John stands up and says, look, boys, here he is. Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. On the very self same day, they found out that on the unleavened bread, the very self same day, Christ was in the tomb. They found out the very self same time, 40 years after he rose, the first fruits or the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Now, this is the early founders of Adventists saw this. And they discovered that when Christ came the first time, he fulfilled. What did I tell you about fulfill? Christ took the written word and brought it out and fulfilled it to where you could see it. The founders of Christianity saw the fulfillment of the first four feasts. They went a little further and they found out that William Miller on Tishri 1 was blowing the trumpet. Blowing the trumpet. And when you read the Old Testament, it says before the Day of Atonement, the horn is blown and people were to prepare for this great event. So on Tishri 1, the trumpet was blown. William Miller was preaching the Advent message. Now, all this they discovered. Now, when the trumpets blew, and it was the Feast of the Trumpets, something special happened. The people just shut down. They cut off their work. They wouldn't do nothing. They got their hearts right because the Day of Atonement was very special because that's the day decisions were made as to who would die, who would live, and who would be pardoned and forgiven. Yes. Are you with me still? Yes. Now, on Tishri 10 was the Day of Atonement. Now, this is where the judgment comes in. The judgment to us is the same thing that atonement was for them. And the Jew still observes the atonement. If the atonement is one meant with God. So the trumpet was blown. People stopped their work. And they said, we can't do nothing else. We got to get this thing right. Because the high priest is going in before the Father. And there's nothing can be left on us. If it is, we die. They got their wrongs right. They wouldn't confess their sins to each other. If somebody had wronged somebody, if somebody had stolen something, they put it back. They got on their knees. They prayed. They agonized. Because and 10 days after the trumpets, the high priest went into the most holy place on the Day of Atonement. Guess what they found out? These are forefathers now of Adventism. They found out that the 10th day, Tishri 10, was October 22, 2,300 days after, or years after, the decree went out for Artaxerxes. Exactly. You know, this is facts. See, now, this has been hidden from Seventh-day Adventists. It was hidden from me. I just happened to go to the Michigan Conference office and dug around in there, and lo and behold, this is what I found. I said, how in the world is it going to be up here? And I didn't see it. Nobody told me about this. October 22, 1844 is when Jesus, our high priest, went in before his father to talk about, who do you think he's going to talk about?
Us.
It's our court date in heaven made visible. And he asked Seventh-day Adventists, would you please go forth and tell the world what I'm doing for you? Since October 22, 1844, Jesus has been talking to the Father about you and about me. Now, what in the world is he saying about us? I mean, he is saddened. This three angels' message and this gospel of the kingdom, Seventh-day Adventists have declared it doesn't exist. We don't hear nothing about no judgment no more, or do you? Don't hear. Don't know nothing about it. Now, I told you, Jesus tells us what he wants to do to save us. And we have an enemy that does not want you to hear it, understand it, or get it. And he's in opposition to us. And he does everything in the world to keep you from knowing that. Now, Jesus is there. He left here, put the Spirit in you, and said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And when I get ready, I'm going to come back and get you. Now, that's good news to me, because I want to get out of here. I want to get in there bad. I'm sick of this place. No, you have to be tired of it. See, anytime, now go and tell it. See, now what we do? No, we don't know. We don't tell that. No, that's out of the norm. But the Lord showed Mrs. White the way to introduce this is through the medical missionary work by what folk eat. And what, if they're sick, help them get well. That introduces them to that. That's the right arm, and it's been cut off. Now, what did I do? I took the instructions of the system. Now, the system of Adventism is just like the system of Judaism. Who? Did you hear what I said? The system of Judaism was to proclaim Jesus Christ coming the first time. But the system of Judaism clogged it up, changed it around, and when he did come, they missed him. They missed him the first time. He's standing up, the Son of God, the Savior of the world, and the elders and the priests talked against him. So they missed him. To Seventh-day Adventists, the same thing. The system teaches you about him, but it throws you off from him. And if we are not careful, we will miss him again. Now, Mrs. White, bless her heart, came out of this system. She's learned that the first four illustrations, feasts, fulfilled the first event. And they discovered the last three will be fulfilled when he comes a second time. Now, that's pretty clear to me. I understand that. That's what Jesus is to me. He's in the most holy place standing up for me. Now, I believe that. Now, you have to have faith. Now, he give us all that to increase your faith in what he said. Let me read something to you. all who believe Jesus pass in solemn view before God, beginning with those who first lived on the earth. Our advocate, there he is again, examines the cases of each successive generation and closes with the living. Every name is mentioned, every case closely investigated. Did you know that somebody's investigating you? Now, if you know that, why in the world do we act the way we do sometimes? No, I'm serious. See, the Lord tells us stuff, and it goes right over our head. He ain't talking about me. No, it ain't got involved with me. The Lord is telling you. I'm checking you out. You're not going to get away with nothing because if I didn't let the devil get away with it, I ain't letting you get away with it. But Christ, here he is again. See? Now ask that this plan be carried out in effect as if a man had never fallen. Boy, the plan that he's talking about is in the most holy place. He's talking to the Father about you. And he tells the Father, listen, I'm the one who died for all those folk. Listen, if they accept me, I'll act and show just like they've never done wrong. That's Jesus again. I told you last night that Jesus is everything you need to be saved. It's a gift that he's giving you free of charge just for you to exercise your ability to believe and you exercise in your mind to choose him. It's a free gift. You can't work for it. You can't pay for it. You can't pass out tracts for it. You can't give a number of Bible studies for it. You can't preach for it. It's free. Amen. We have to somehow get that through our heads. Christ now asks that this plan be carried into effect as if man had never fallen. He asks for his people not only pardon and justification, full and complete, but a share in glory, a seat upon his throne. Lord have mercy. God says, listen. Jesus said, listen, I want you here. And I want you here so bad that if you accept me in my blood by faith, I'll invite you up here and will declare you just and righteous and set you down on my throne. Now, I don't see how in the world that do excite somebody. No, sir. Now, listen, on the other hand now, the devil don't like that. See, he don't like that plan. The plan was made from the foundation of the world that Jesus Christ would die, give his blood to sanctify, cleanse, and forgive us. And the blood is being applied now in the judgment for every man, woman, and child. And he asked Evans, would you all please tell folk that? Would you please warn them that what I'm doing up here? I had to leave there and leave my spirit here to help you know where I'm at. So I'm up here with my Father trying my best to redeem somebody from the earth. The deceiver has sought to lead them into skepticism to cause them to lose confidence in God, to separate them from his love and break his law. Adventists. Well, I've been looking for the Lord to come all these years. He ain't come yet. Skeptic. Now I'm going on out and do what I want to do. I'm going to believe what I want to believe and go where I want to go. Skeptic. Because he didn't put in your head, the Lord didn't forget him. Now the devil points to their defects in character. Say, oh, listen, I've been trying to do this all along. I want to drink me some beer, but I'm going to go get it now. The Lord ain't coming. I want to go and I want to steal a little bit. I'm going to do whatever I want to do because the devil points to your defects. And instead of you remembering what Jesus told you about your defects, you listen to what the devil told you about your defects. Jesus tells you about your defects. If you confess and forsake your defects, he will cleanse you of all our stuff. The devil comes along and says, oh, no, buddy, I ain't going to let you get away with this here. I'm going to remind you of what you did, how you said it, and you don't deserve to go nowhere. And we believe that. Lord have mercy. To all the sins which he has tempted them to commit. And because of these, he claims them as his subjects. So them folks belong to me. Now you said they belong to you. They belong to me. Look what he did the other day. Here again, Jesus does not excuse their sins, but shows their repentance and faith. And claiming for them forgiveness, he lifts his hands before the Father and the holy angels and says, I know them by name. Amen. See, I want the Lord to know me by name. Amen. I have graven them on the palms of my hand. Amen. Look at this scar. He's mine. I know him. He knows me. I've kept him and engraved on my hands who he is. Christ will place his own signet upon his faithful ones that he may present them to his Father, a glorious church. Now, when you think church, now don't think denomination. Did you hear what I said? A glorious church. Jesus said, the same Mrs. White says that the church is not a cathedral or denomination, but it's made up of whosoever loveth the Lord and keep his commandments. Where two or three are gathered together, that's where I am, and that's what makes up a church. See, but you're looking at the denomination, and he's looking at people scattered all over that don't belong to nothing. And he said, these are mine, and these are the people that are going to be my folks from everywhere, every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. Their names stand enrolled in the book of life, and concerning them it is written, they walk with me in white. They are worthy. Walk in white. White means clean. White means perfect. Jesus said, we are walking with him. Now the devil don't like that. He wants you forever to be mired in the sins that you commit. He never lets you forget them. But Jesus said, if you just believe what I tell you, see, it's hard to believe him because you can't see. You can't see with your eyes. But he tells you in his word. And when you believe it, he says, that's what I'm doing in my Father's house. Would you please tell the other folk that? Now, great and small, low, high and low, rich and poor, are to be judged out of the things written in the books. So you don't get away with nothing. Do you think something is hidden? Didn't see it? No, sir, wrote it down. The angels that are around here keep the records on folks. See, we don't believe that. If you believe that, you wouldn't do what you do. You wouldn't try to cheat nobody. You wouldn't try to tell no lies deliberately. No, because you know somebody's writing it down, especially if you call yourself a Christian. There's a record book that's kept of you. The books of remembrance are kept. Everything you do, day after day, is passing into eternity, bears the burden of records for the books of heaven. Words once spoken, deeds once done, can never be recalled. Angels of God have registered both the evil and the good. The mightiest conqueror on earth cannot call back the record even of a single day. You say, you can't remember what you did. You don't remember what you did. But that record reveals that. And the only way to get that off the record It's accept Jesus by faith. So the records are being gone over in heaven. Now just put your head on this. Now, the thought come to me, but the computer, you know, you got your name up there and all the stuff that you did and when you did it and where you lived and where you come from, all, and it identifies you. And then the devil appears up there. And he says, now look, you know that man ain't right. You look what that woman did. And if you've given your heart to the Lord and the Holy Spirit has controlled what you did down here and is in control of what you are doing down here, he looks at all that stuff. And then like on the computer, he puts a color on it, a black on it or a blue on it. And then he hits, boom, delete, gone. Blot it out. The name stands in the book of life. But if you have not accepted Jesus Christ in the spirit, don't live in you. See, on the earthly sanctuary, if you was not in line with the high priest while he was in there on that one day, see, back there was a one day, but now it's a period of time. It's from 1844 until the close of probation. He's giving you time. Amen. So on that one day, if they were caught deliberately doing wrong while that high priest was in that most holy place before God, they found him and killed him. You just didn't walk around and deliberately disobey and act a fool while that high priest was up there. No, sir. And stay alive. But here we are in mercy. The Lord is long-suffering. You make a mistake, ask for forgiveness, he blots it out. Amen. Now, how can you beat that? Because the Lord wants you back. Jesus wants you back. He wants to redeem you. He wants to cleanse you. He wants to have you walking like, looking like, talking like him on this earth. Amen. And the only way to do that is let the Spirit live in you. Amen. Satan invents unnumbered schemes to occupy our minds. See, the devil wants your head, that they may not dwell upon the work which we ought to be best acquainted. Now, this is Mrs. White informing us. Now, the devil then planned a scheme to keep you busy, keep you worried, keep you upset, keep you troubled, because he don't want you to get what I'm just telling you. That's why you ain't got it. You ain't seen that. And that's been out there since 1855. You didn't see it. Never got it. Busy. Busy, though. Busy going here. Busy going there. Busy working for the church. Busy following the pastor. The arch deceiver hates the great truths that bring to the view in atoning sacrifices and an all-powered mediator. He knows that with him, everything now depends on his deriving our minds from Jesus and the truth. If he knows that you ever get Jesus in your heart, he will never have a chance at getting you. That's why he keeps you busy. Now listen to this. Now let's listen to this. Now she talked to us. Just like the prophets talked to the people of old. She's talking to us. The subject of the sanctuary and the investigative judgment should be clearly understood by the people of God. Do you clearly understand it? If you don't clearly understand it, you're missing the point. And you ain't never heard it. And that's sad. Now that is really earth-shaking to me. And it was earth-shaking to me when I found it there. The intercession of Christ in man's behalf in the sanctuary above is as essential to the plan of salvation as it was his death on the cross. Oh, the death of Jesus was so important. How he hung there and suffered. and bled and died for all the wrongs that I did. And she says, to understand the intercession of Christ is just as much important as that. Now, Jesus did all that for you. He went back to heaven and was talking to his Father about you again. And you don't know nothing about it. Boy, now that thing makes me scared. That thing makes me scared. We must, by faith, enter within the veil. For the forerunner is for us centered. Jesus Christ is within that earthly veil in the most holy place. He's trying his best to intercede for us. All who would have their names retained in the book of life now should now, in the few remaining days of probation, afflict their souls before God by being sorry for their sins and true repentance. That's afflicting your soul. There must be a deep, faithful searching of the heart. Now, when do you ever search yourself? We don't do that. We're too busy with the worldly stuff. The light, frivolous spirit indulged by the majority of the professed Christians must be put away. There is earnest warfare before all who would subdue the evil tendencies that strive for the mastery. You're in a battle. You're in a battle, and most of the time you don't even know it. You're enjoying yourself. Going here, going there, buying this, buying that. Enjoying all that. The devil said, yeah, help yourself. Enjoy what you're doing. Go on, keep on at it. Jesus up there said, listen, won't you pay attention to what I'm doing? I'm up here trying to fight for you. And the only way I can fight for you is for you to have the Holy Spirit in you down here so you won't look like I'm up. The Lord ain't going to look like out of this world. Now he up there fighting for you to be saved and you down there cutting up. Making all kind of mistakes, all kind of errors, and enjoying making them errors. No, you got to afflict your soul. Get yourself together. How perilous is the condition of those who, growing weary of their watch, turn to the attractions of the world. Seventh-day Adventists have forgotten this important message and have turned to the world. The reason why you don't hear this is because the leaders have turned your head away from it. See, the Seventh-day Adventist Corporation apostatized the first time in 1888. Just like the Jews back there then apostatized from turning against Jesus. And then in 1955, they apostatized again and said, this, you don't have to know, teach, or believe no more. That's the reason why you don't have it. Afflicting your soul, agonizing with God, letting him know how you want the Spirit to live in you. This is our work, because Jesus, when he stands up, when all of this is over, the Bible tells me that God is going to marry his people up there to Jesus. His people, his spot, his church, without a spot or wrinkle. He's going to marry it up there. See, they told me he was going to marry them down here. Now they told you the same thing. He's coming back as a bride prepared for his husband. And say he was coming back. We're going to welcome him with outstretched arm. That's what they taught. But the Bible tells me, because I read it, God is going to marry the church to his people up there. Then he's going to come back down here to receive them. All those who have cleared the atonement, the judgment, his people will be at one with him. His people. They'll be at one in harmony and in peace to live with the Father forever. The whole plan of salvation that was laid before the foundation of the world will be completed with Jesus doing it all. He gives you the faith. He teaches you and guides you. He brings back to your remembrance. He convicts you of sin. And then he stands up in front of the Father and declares you righteous and just and honorable and declares that you all right to live with his Father in heaven. Now, what else can you do but accept that free gift all by faith? Amen. It sounds too easy to be true. And that's the reason why folk don't believe it. But I want to be ready when Jesus comes by following his plan. Don't you? Amen. If you want to be ready when Jesus comes, just bow your head and close your eyes. Father, we thank thee for the plan that you've given us and told us step by step by step and showed us how we can go right into your kingdom if we just follow you and let your spirit lead and guide us. We are sorry for being misled and misguided. But Lord, you put us back on the track. And a few of us love you, understand you, and trying to obey you. Help us all, Lord, to practice what you told us and be ready when you return. We ask this all in Jesus' worthy, wonderful name. Amen. And how do I cut this off? Okay. Thanks.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
What happened to Temperance 12?
I didn't get into
okay,
that.
Okay, no problem.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay,
very good. I didn't want to run over time.
Don't forget to take your chair when you go out, and this will dismiss this service. And we'll have lunch within, hopefully, 20 to 30 minutes.